if you've got multiple processors, either that's multiple cores, virtual cores in a hyperthreaded processor, or actually a multi-core processor, you want to run your algorithm or on multiple CPU instances. So you need to split it up, and the operating system needs to find some way of controlling all those different instances. Actually, it can still be beneficial on a single CPU system, because there might be times where part of your program is waiting for, say, network input, so the operating system will then schedule in another thread of execution to do something. So let's start by thinking about what the operating system sees when it's running a program. And this is what's called a process. And that's got a series of instructions that it's going to be executing. This is the program. This is actually not part of the operating system, it's the program, but it needs to know where inside the program that is. So it's that instruction, say. But there's also lots of other information that the operating system needs to keep track for a process. So things like list of open files, configuration of memory, and so on, if you've got virtual memory involved, or paging. There's just various things that the operating system needs to keep track. Each of them has got a unique ID, and you can then run multiple processes at the same time. So one way you could break your program up into multiple chunks is to actually have multiple processes running. And for a while, people did this. They sort of would use the command, a function in Unix, for example, called fork, and it would split the program in two, one half which would run off as it was, the other would have a new process identifier, and the operating system would copy that block and create a new list of what memory it uses, a new list of the files it had open. Now, these would point back to the same files, the same blocks, memory allocations and things, so that if you changed one memory location, it updated on the other side and things. If you changed a file, a seek to a different part of a file, for example, it would update in the others. But they would be separate processes, and they'd have to have all the storage required to do that. And that worked, but if you're just breaking your program up so you can run your task on multiple CPUs, most of them are going to have the same list of files, the same memory configuration, the same everything else that the operating system needs to keep track of. The only thing that's going to be different is where it is in the program, what bit of code it's running from what part. And so the idea that came along was, okay, well, let's have something lighter weight than a process. And they called it a thread because you've got your thread of execution through the instructions. And what we'll have is that each process will have at least one thread of execution, but could have many. So you have multiple threads of execution in your program. So your program's running one thread, which it starts off with. That will then create another thread, which does something, and then another thread, perhaps, and so on, can do different parts. They may last for the whole length of the program. They may only last for a short part while that task's being completed, and so on. You may have multiple ones that get jobs from different things, and so on. How you structure your program doesn't matter, but from the operating system's point of view, it's now scheduling different threads onto the different cores, whether that's one, two, four, however many you've got in your system. So the idea behind multithreading is a sort of lightweight way of saying to the operating system, these are the different things that I want running on my computer, whether that's all as part of one program or multiple threads through multiple programs. And the operating system's choosing which one of them actually gets CPU times on any of the CPU cores, physical or virtual, that they have available. Now that introduces, if you're writing one program that you've split into multiple threads, that introduces some interesting issues, because you can get to the point where your programs can no longer do the tasks that you expect them to do. A program which was just one single stream of instructions executing one after the other, and so you knew the order they'd execute into, to multiple threads of instruction that are executing, sometimes in parallel, sometimes one after the other, but you no longer have any control over the order that would happen, because the operating system might put two of the threads on at the same time, or it might let one thread run and then put the other thread on after the other and then go back, and you can't control where it'd switch from one to the other. I can show this with an interesting program on my laptop. So what I've got here is I'm going to write a program that adds up all the numbers from 1 to 1 million, but I'm going to do that in two threads. So I've written two threads here. I'm going to create two threads. The first one is this routine here, which is called the helpfully thread function. We've got a variable a, which we're going to initialize to be 0. And I've declared this as a volatile variable, just to tell the C compiler that it will change when it's running, because otherwise you'd have even more problems. So I split it in two. So the first one is adding up the first 500,000. The second one, exactly the same, except it's adding up the second 500,000. So what it's doing is it's adding up from 500,000 to 1 million, and they're adding them to the same variable. So we've got instruction is going to fetch one add it on the next one and write it back, and then the other one's going to fetch it, add on a value and write it back, and so on. So then we then run our program, we create both threads, and then we wait for them to complete, which is what this pthread join is doing, and then we print out the number that we've got. So if you would like to add up all the numbers between 1 and 1,000,000 while I run the program, then we'll see what result we get.
500 billion?
So let's just compile this up. Not made any mistakes in the program, so we compile this up and let's just run this program. And it's given me the answer 28668974820. If I run it again, I now get the answer 33396382672. If I run it again, I get the answer 32687040952. If I run it again, I get 243075015492, which sounds like a phone number.
Will this all converge on the right answer, or will it average out, or is this just one of those completely...
Well, if you think about it, it should always be the same. You're adding up all the numbers between 1 and 1,000,000. You should always get the same answer. It shouldn't be converging on something. It should always be producing the same answer. So something very, very odd is going on my computer. Something very, very bizarre is going on. We could write the program... In fact, let's just write the program normally. Let's comment out all this. And we'll just write a very quick program that adds up all the values from 1 to 1,000,000. So while I is less than or equal to 1 precise. So we've made it a single-threaded program now. It's just going to run on one thread. And if we do that, we recompile it, we now get the same value each time, 500 and whatever that is.
So now we've gone single-threaded, we're getting the right answer.
And we're getting the same answer each time. So what's going on here? Well, you need to think about what's happening in this program. So let's just put it back to where it was. If we look at this instruction here, A equals A plus I, then what we're telling this program to do is to fetch the value of A, whatever that is, then add on the value of I to it, and then store the result back in A. Now, if I just put that to one side and find my paper, which is over here with my pens. If we were to write that in machine code, and I'll use the ARM chip to do that because it just makes things slightly easier to see what's going on. We would have, this is thread one, so we'll call this T1. We're going to say that this is going to be an LDR instruction to load a value from memory. So we're going to load into a register, let's use R0, the value of A. We're then going to add on to R0, the value of R1, which is a register containing our loop counter. That's the same as I on there. And then we're going to store the value of R0 back in A. So that one C instruction becomes three machine code instructions. So the way that the program is executing in one thread is it's loading the value from memory and it's making a local copy of it. And then it adds a value onto it, updates its local copy, and stores it back into the actual location. And that thread keeps doing that into a loop. So it loads it, adds something onto it, and stores it back. Loads it, adds something onto it, stores it back. Now, if we've got a multi-threaded system, which is what we had there, we also have another Steve. Hi, Steve. Hi, Steve. And in that case, I'm going to be here loading the value, adding a value onto it, storing it back. And I'm going to be here loading a value, adding something onto it, and storing it back. So I'm loading a value, adding something onto it. Storing I'm loading a value, back. Loading a value, adding something onto it, something onto
storing it back.
Storing it back. And what's just happened, because other Steve had added something else onto it while I'd loaded on, when I store mine back, his update doesn't get changed, it gets lost. Well, that wasn't nice. So if we look at what's happening on the paper, it's loading the value in, it's adding the value onto it, and then it's storing it back. But of course, we've got multiple systems. And so at some point, this program is going to start executing the same code. So let's cross this instruction out for now. We'll put it back in a bit later on. And assume that at this point, we load the value into the other thread, into R0 in there. And then we do the add-on in the same way, dot, 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 dot. And then we do the store back here of R0 into A. And we've got one A up here that we're accessing. And then this store actually happens after this store here. So what happens here is that these both end up getting the same value of A. This adds its value on in its local register. This adds its value 1 in its local register. This stores it back. Then this stores it back. And of course, because this has just stored it back here, it's overwritten the value that was stored there. So the value that was added on here gets lost. So what we need to do is find a way to synchronize these two things so that as soon as this has loaded the value in and is going to add something onto it, it stops this one from doing it. And so there's a couple of ways we can do that. The easiest way is that we have something that both Steves or both CPUs have to access. And so we could have a token. Let's use a floppy disk, Microsoft Office Professional, 1995. And what we're going to say is that I can only access and update variable A if I have the token. So let's bring back friendly Steve. So we've now got a token, and what we're going to say is that unless I've got the token, I cannot access the variable A. So I'm going to execute those three instructions whenever I've got the token. So I'm going to load a value in, add something onto it, and store it back. And then I'm going to hand the token to Steve. Now I've got the token, so I can load a value in, add the value from on my register into it, and store it back and hand the token. And now I've got the token again, I can load something into my register, add something onto it, throw it back, and pass the token on. And I've got it, so I can load the value in, add the value from my register, store it back, and pass the token on. And because I've got the token again, I can do the same again. But because only one of us can hold the token at any one time, it means that only A can get updated when we've got the token. And so we never lose that right, because we're saying that unless you've got the token, you can't access that variable. That's great. So if we turn back to the laptop, we can see how we can implement that in our program. We're going to use the same idea. We're going to have something that we need to have before we can run that code. In this case, we're going to have what's called a mutex, an area of mutual exclusion, that we need to lock before we can run the code after it. And then when we finished, we unlock that. And so if it's locked and we try and acquire it, our program will pause until it is able to lock it. So what I'm going to do is I've created the variable for it here, and I've also initialized it down here, so it's all set up, ready to go. So before I add onto A the value of the instructions, I'm going to lock that mutex, like so. And then afterwards, if I could type, I'm going to unlock that mutex, like so. And I need to do the same in the other thread as well. So I'm going to lock the mutex, and then I'm going to unlock it afterwards. So if I compile this version up, we've still got two threads. We're still getting them to add up the things as we go through it. And then at the end, we're going to print the result. And it should, this time, give us the right answer. So let's run it. And it gives us the right answer. We now split the problem in two. It's running on two CPUs. And because we're locking that variable, so we can only access it by one thread or the other, just as we did with the two Steves, then we can get the right result. And it produces the same result every time. Now the downside to this is that locking the thread each time slows the running of the program down. But we can be clever. If we think about addition, if we add six numbers together, that's the same as adding three numbers together, then adding three numbers together and adding the results of both together. And we can do the same thing here. So we can take this mutex and move it outside of our main loop. And instead of adding on the value of I each time, we have a local variable, we'll call it local A, which we add everything onto. So we say local A equals local A plus I. So inside our thread, we're just going around adding all the values on as we did before, which didn't work, but because we're putting it in a local variable that's local to that thread and this function, it's not going to be a problem because only this function can access it. We'll do the same in the other thread, and then we'll do the same thing outside it. And the advantage of doing this is that we now only have to acquire that lock once in each thread. Rather than having to acquire it for every single addition, we only have to acquire it once. So if we time the program beforehand, and I should say at this point, the program may be running so fast that we won't be able to get an accurate time on it. We can try it anyway. So we use the time command to time it. We see it takes about 0.82 seconds. Let's just run it again. 0.71. We seem to have standardized around that sort of thing. So about 0.7. So let's compile up our faster version now. Not made any mistakes. And we'll time it again. Well, let's see if it produces the right value. We'll time it as well. And it's taking around the same time. Like it's dropping a bit. It doesn't really make any difference in time. I think that's just because of how fast the computers are that we're dealing with. But with a bigger program, doing more calculations, reducing the number of times we acquire that lock would actually make the system run faster. So multithreading is the idea of breaking our program up into multiple threads of execution that run for different lengths of time, but we have to be careful that we do things in the right order and we avoid having multiple threads accessing the same variable at the same time, particularly if they're writing. If they're just reading from it, it doesn't matter. Or if one's writing and several are reading from it, and it doesn't matter if they perhaps get an older value at a time, then it works fine, and so on.
Produces that same A1 so that he can decrypt the message and read it, right? So Alice maybe wants to send another one. So she's going to tick this KDF function again. She's going to produce a new key and A2. Right, she's going to send that to Bob. He's going to tick this receiving function A2. Now Bob wants to send a message, so he's going to tick here.